What is BRICS? BRICS, or Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, is a group of five leading emerging economies. BRICS emerged in 2001 as BRIC, and was later joined by South Africa in 2010. The group became a formal geopolitical entity from 2009 onwards, with summits and coordination of policies. The BRICS countries account for around 27% of the world's land surface, and approximately 42% of the global population. The grouping is considered a competitor to the G7 bloc, with competing institutions and initiatives in the areas of development economics, financial reserves, currencies, and payments.
Make sure you guys hit that subscribe button, hit that notification bell so that you always know when we have brand new content so you won't miss a thing. And things you need to know. I am your host, President Ramaphosa of South Africa. Yes. If you guys are at BitChute watching, thank you for coming back. If you guys are at YouTube watching, thank you for coming back while we have the chance to bring you these episodes. And if you are at Gab or the Rumble watching, well, thank you. So, one of the things that I've been doing as the President of South Africa is getting together with Brazil, Russia, India, and China to help start a new group world economy known as BRICS. What is BRICS, you ask? Let's find out.
Periodically, talk of ways to reduce or eliminate dependence on the US dollar pop up in varied economies globally. The latest comes from the BRICS nations, who have announced their intention to create a gold-backed BRICS currency. BRICS is the acronym for a group of countries started in 2010 by Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. The alliance expects to expand its membership soon, with over 20 countries formally asking to join BRICS, making the group economically formidable.
BRICS. Magnitude of impact. The BRICS nations go beyond being just letters. They hold a tremendous and transformative power that echoes throughout the world stage. Their combined presence encompasses a staggering 42% of the world's population, serving as the crucible for the aspirations, dreams, and untapped potential of over 3.27 billion individuals. However, what is truly breathtaking is the colossal magnitude of their combined gross domestic product, GDP. A staggering amount approaching $26 trillion, a value that slightly exceeds even the economic might of the United States. Nevertheless, a closer examination reveals the crucial role of China's economic strength, significantly enhancing these astonishing figures.
So BRICS basically means Brazil, Russia, India, China, as a basically a organization. It was coined by Goldman Sachs in 2001, and they are expected to be a collective global economy by 2050. This will rival the current IMF, which is being ran by most of the Western nations like France, Germany, America, the UK. Well, not even the UK, Australia, you know, other nations like that. In the UK, in Europe, they actually have the euro system, which the UK broke out of when Brexit happened under Boris Johnson in 2017 or 2018, I believe. Now, China is one of the biggest contributors, as well as Russia. That should make you ask the question, what's going on with the Ukrainian war? If a BRICS discussion is happening, what exactly is going on in that Ukrainian war? What could be happening in future wars? You gotta ask yourself that question, because if you get all those nations together, that means that they're gonna all be together on economic policy as well as probably foreign policy and even wars. It could be on that. They're expecting to do a 2024 expansion, which is slated to include Argentina, Egypt, Ethiopia, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and even the United Arab Emirates. That makes me question this. What's going on with Israel? I know South Africa is not feeling Israel right now.
It was an overwhelming vote in favor of downgrading South Africa's official representation in Tel Aviv. Relations with Israel have been tense for some time now. In 2017, the governing African National Congress downgraded its ties with Israel in response to what it said was ongoing human rights abuses against Palestinians. South Africa's not had an ambassador in Tel Aviv since 2019. While the vote was introduced by the National Freedom Party, it was supported by more than two-thirds of members of parliament. Those opposing it included the main opposition party, the Democratic Alliance, and the African Christian Democratic Party. South Africa's Jewish Board of Deputies says the vote undermines and harms South Africa's own interests.
So it kind of makes me think, well, what is Israel? What role will Israel play in this, as Israel is friends with Saudi Arabia, has recently become okay with United Arab Emirates because of Donald Trump. So it's very strange to see what will happen into the world with this, as Israel functions a lot due to America and its influence on other nations. How will this affect those economies? Will they join as well? Will you start seeing Syria, Libya, Lebanon, all those nations who were needed to be taken down by Israel after 9/11, will they join? It's very interesting. They've had various different summits. The summit started in June 16th of 2009. They've been in various different nations that are a part of the BRICS system. Now, some of you may be saying, how will this affect the American economy? How will America be affected by a BRICS system? What will happen to America's economy? Good question.
Unity amidst diversity. United by their ambitious dreams, the BRICS nations create a vibrant tapestry interwoven with threads of diversity. Across vast geographical landscapes that span continents, these countries unfold economic paths that split and ideological compasses that guide in separate ways. Amidst this remarkable diversity, the member nations embark on unique journeys. Russia sets its sights on forging a potent geopolitical counterbalance to Western influence. South Africa charts a course to assume a pivotal leadership role across the African continent. Brazil envisions itself as a compelling force for empowerment within the global South. India artfully navigates the bridge between its historical leadership and contemporary aspirations. And China strides forward, strategically weaving political influence into the fabric of its surging economic prowess. A pivotal juncture materialized in the transformative year of 2014, birthing two monumental institutions, the New Development Bank, NDB, and the Contingency Reserve Arrangement, CRA. With the NDB, often referred to as the eminent BRICS Bank, a powerful alternative to the International Monetary Fund, IMF, and World Bank emerged. It stands resolute in extending loans to developing nations, unburdened by the conditionalities often associated with Western financial institutions. Complementing this, the Contingency Reserve Arrangement, CRA, was conceived to offer vital financial support to member nations confronting economic adversities. This collective safety net holds the promise of shielding countries from the throes of financial instability, fortifying BRICS's influence in a tangible way.
Well, according to Reuters, they said that BRICS leaders have said that they want to use the national currencies more instead of the dollar, which strengthened sharply last year as the Federal Reserve raised interest rates and Russia invaded Ukraine, making the dollar debt and many imports more expensive. The objective, irreversible process of de-dollarization of our economic ties is gaining momentum, Putin told the summit on Tuesday. De-dollarizing would need countless exporters and importers, as well as borrowers, lenders, and currency traders across the world to independently decide who use other currencies. Now, this is Reuters saying this, so, you know, take with it what you will. It is an organization here in America trying to tell us about how this may not affect any of us at all.
Well, the biggest threat to the U.S. dollar dominance, I think, could be summed up with one acronym, and that acronym is BRICS. Although, if you listen to the Western media talk about BRICS, they downplay its significance. The U.S. dollar is fine, nothing to see here. The rise of China, the rise of Russia, this partnership is of no concern to the United States. Really?
I don't know, though. It is very possible that these particular nations and these particular groups that are working with this could decide to do this, and this could create some very huge havoc with our trade relations overseas. Maybe goods will be more expensive for us. China already creates our medicine, creates most of our goods, produce most of our products here in America. Could the cost of those products go up astronomically because of our dependence upon China? Could China then say, if America doesn't adhere or even recognize a BRICS system or the BRICS currency, they won't trade with us? but they force the American dollar to buy under the BRICS system because they have such control over our economy. And even China is moving into Africa and doing a lot of good things for different African nations like Nigeria and other African nations.
Africa no longer bows to the US. Much of the continent is now economically and politically aligned with the world's fastest emerging superpower, China. The simple answer for why this is because China has pumped huge amounts of money into the continent of Africa. They're buying allies. For example, China built a $3.2 billion railway in Kenya, trekking the 300 miles from Nairobi, the capital, to Mombasa, the second largest city and primary port, in 4 hours and 30 minutes. That's faster than what the fastest train in the US, the Acela Express, takes to travel the equivalent distance from Philadelphia to Boston. China also built a $526 million dam in Guinea, which helped push the country from having constant power shortages to making more energy than it needs and selling the extra capacity to its neighbors. China also built a $475 million light rail system in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, the first of its kind in sub-Saharan Africa, designed as a way to combat the capital's crippling traffic. These are only a sampling. There are literally hundreds of others of Chinese infrastructure projects in Africa each year. All across the continent, China is playing a part in projects both big and small that are transforming African economies. It's important to note that these projects are not, though, free. Each of these three were financed by loans granted by China's state-owned and controlled Export-Import Bank, and these loans do, of course, need to be paid back by the countries granted them. Large African infrastructure projects, though, would be viewed as risky by any traditional bank and would therefore struggle to get financed, but China's Export-Import Bank doesn't care. Assuming cooperation between the Chinese and African countries' governments, this bank will give low-interest or no-interest loans to African countries so they can build these trains or dams or other projects. These loans are therefore considered a form of foreign aid since China doesn't expect to get all their money back, at least adjusted for inflation, since they're not charging much interest and there's a high risk of default. Of course, China isn't just financing these projects out of kindness. For each of them, there's a political goal behind it. You see, the country of China is running out of growth potential. Its era of double-digit year-over-year GDP growth is over as it makes the shift from industrializing to industrialized. Africa, meanwhile, is one of the least developed areas of the world, and a lack of development actually makes fast growth easy. The first step of economic development for many countries is natural resource exploitation. Nearly every country has some level of natural resources that can be used to kickstart growth, but first they need to have enough money to build the infrastructure and take the steps needed to gather these natural resources. As everyone knows, it takes money to make money, and China has money. By investing in African mining and farming, China can profit off Africa's growth and fuel the business back in China that requires minerals and food. But in addition to serving as a source of natural resources, Africa has another resource: labor.
So with China doing that, moving into Africa, helping out African nations, having control over our things that we make over here, it's possible that they can get us all on board with that, despite what Reuters is saying in their article. What I find interesting about this, from another standpoint, is I remember a man named Muammar Gaddafi trying to do something similar like this with the gold dinar in Libya.
Wherever people long to be free, they will find a friend in the United States.
Gaddafi took the example of Gamal Abdel Nasser, who, like himself, came to power in a military coup in Egypt and became the leader of the Arab world. He tried to implement the reforms carried out in Egypt in his own country. British and US military bases and troops were driven out of the country. He criticized the oil companies nationally. He confiscated the property of the Italian and Jewish minorities, forcing them to emigrate. After Gaddafi came to power, he undersigned major development projects in Libya. National income per capita in Libya was higher than other oil-producing countries in 2010. Libya was no longer a poor country and there were no serious economic problems. During the Gaddafi era, the literacy rate reached 86% and the quality of life improved. Again, under his rule, serious progress was made, especially in the construction sector. So much so that many Turkish businessmen and workers went from Turkey to Libya during this period. This situation continued until the civil war period.
But some are convinced intervention in Libya is all about currency, specifically Gaddafi's plan to introduce the gold dinar, a single African currency made from gold, a true sharing of the wealth.
It's one of these things that you have to plan almost in secret. because as soon as you say you're going to change over from the dollar to the something else, you're going to be targeted. There were two conferences on this, one in 96 and another one in the year 2000, called the World Mataba Conference, organized by Gaddafi. And everybody was interested. I think most countries in Africa were keen.
Gaddafi didn't give up. In the months leading up to the military intervention, he called on African and Muslim nations to join together to create this new currency that would rival the dollar and euro. They would sell oil and other resources around the world only for gold dinars. It's an idea that would shift the economic balance of the world. Countries' wealth would depend on how much gold they have, not how many dollars they trade. And Libya has 144 tons of gold. The UK has double that, but 10 times the population.
And do whatever it takes to bring down Gaddafi and usher in a new government.
A gold dinar would have had serious consequences for the world financial system, but may also have empowered the people of Africa, something black activists say the U.S. wants to avoid at all costs.
Many people say it was the government, the United States government, was not going to allow that. Is it possible that all of these leaders, this Ukrainian fight, is it possible that the Ukrainian fight could be NATO saying, hey, not only do we need to fight Russia, but we also need to stop this BRICS system, and we can start a possible World War III under the guise of fighting for Ukrainian refugees when actually we're fighting for economic supremacy. BRICS system may cause a possible World War III that many people do not see coming, because of course many of the American people are too focused on UFOs and what's going on with Trump to really pay attention to what's going on internationally. What's also interesting is I could have sworn when the euro happened, this was kind of similar. All of those nations over there in Europe function under the European system, the euro system, where they utilize that one currency, the European Union. And, you know, if the economy collapses in Europe and it's not well, then that means that the whole institution will collapse. It is possible that BRICS could collapse and not be good, and be something that fails, and all those nations' economies could fail. And then what would happen then? Will their burdens become debt to the Americans and to the IMF? Is that possibly the plan? Is it possible that America is involved in BRICS anyway and trying to create this system to create these problems so that they can eventually need America? Who knows? I don't know. You tell me in the comment section. I would love to know what you guys think about BRICS. I don't have an opinion either way. I'm very curious to see what will happen more with this. If they are slated to be the big global dominating force by 2050, that should be interesting. That's in approximately 20 plus years. With America so focused on identity and trying to divide its own people up through a cultural civil war, it's very possible that Russia, China, and all of these nations may be able to do this, because they will see an opportunity with all the Western nations fighting cultural civil wars amongst each other. They may say, hey, there's an opportunity for us to not only fund those cultural wars, but also go into those schools of America and all those other nations and fund those schools, and also go into their businesses and fund their businesses, because they're too busy putting their money into fighting each other. So the only thing left to do if you want to dominate them is to fund their elections, fund their politicians, fund their businesses, fund their television, fund their entertainment, and essentially you will have full control over the American people's thinking. And then maybe a BRICS system fully works. I don't know. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. You guys tell me. I'd love to know what all of you all think. Let's talk more about this. If you have some information that you think would be helpful to understanding BRICS, or even some information that you know about who's really behind BRICS, leave that in the comment section. I'd love to see it. I'll always do a part two if there's more information to find out, especially if there's a conspiracy. I'd love to do that. You guys know how it is here at Random Radio. We like to dig, and digging we shall do to find out what's going on with BRICS. How will it affect the Americas? How will it affect the Western world? How will it affect you? We'll find out. Because apparently, this is going to happen. No matter what, this is going to happen. So your racism, your feminism, your climate change, all of that seems to be more important, you think. Better start wising up and paying attention, because the other nations out there that don't have those problems or are not promoting those problems on their people, trying to break away from America's money and the stranglehold that America has on their economies. They're trying to figure out a way to make America the Americans submit to them. All right, I'll see you guys in the next one. And this is something that you needed to know. Random Radio. Yeah, boy!